a jig would be perfect.
I didn't think about that, but if you start playing out far away, that's going to get
tough. Well, I thought if they're ending the service, you know, if they don't have anybody else, it's...
Thank you.
Thank you, band. Always a great way to get us started on these Sunday mornings. We're so glad to look out here and see so many people. Welcome to 909 at Highlands United Methodist Church. We are glad you're here this morning. What a beautiful way to start our day. A little nippy out there, and the trees are just doing magical, amazing things. So we are glad we're here to worship together. So let us go to the Lord in prayer. Get our hearts right. Almighty and merciful God, we need you so much, and we thank you for these opportunities to come together on Sunday mornings to worship you and to get our week started off the right way. So, Lord, we just ask that you would guide us this morning, get our hearts right, and may our worship be pleasing to you. In the holy name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. All right, got a couple fun songs to get us started, Victory in Jesus and Life's Highway to Heaven, so we can all rise and sing to your heart's desire.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He got me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He won me in victory, beneath the cleansing blood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea. About the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me in victory beneath the cleansing blood.
Yeah. Another one.
Life is like a mountain railroad with an engineer that's brave. We must make the run successful from the cradle to the grave. Watch the curve, feel the tunnel, never falter, never fail. Keep your hand upon the throttle and your eye upon the rail. Blessed Savior, thou wilt guide us till we reach that blissful shore, where the angels wait to join us in our praise forevermore. You will roll up grades of trial, you will cross that bridge of strife. See that Christ is your conductor on a lightning train of life. Always mindful of obstruction, do your duty, never fail. Keep your hand upon the throttle and your right upon me. Blessed Savior, now we'll guide us till we reach that blissful shore, where the angels wait to join us in our praise forevermore. We will often find obstruction, look for storms, wind and rain. On a field, a curve of treasure, you'll almost ditch your train. Put your trust alone in Jesus, never falter, never fail. Keep your hand upon the throttle and your eye upon the rail. Blessed Savior, now we'll guide us till we reach that blissful shore, where the angels wait to join us in our praise forevermore. And you roll across the trestle, spanning Jordan's swelling tide. We behold the Union Depot, onto its shore train will guide. There you meet the superintendent, God the Father, God the Son, with a hearty joyous party, the pilgrim will come home. Blessed Savior, thou wilt guide us till we reach that blissful shore, where the angels wait to join us in thy bed forevermore.
Woo! Let's quit that song.
Are you sure there's not one more verse you want to get out of there, Lee? I don't know. I'm not sure what Lee had for breakfast, but I want some of it. So
no, you...
let's hear it for the band, Lee, Darren, Layla, and Charles. I mean, talk about joys. We are grateful for them every week. They come from Canton, South Carolina, Lee, right around the corner. But we are so thankful you guys join us each morning up here. So thank you. And also, let's hear it for Christy and Ed and the team in the kitchen. Whipping up those great breakfasts. Everybody looks full and happy. Let's stay awake, okay? Let's not get too sleepy. All that good food in your belly. So I sometimes forget to remind at the beginning, so I'm going to remind you now. We have at the end of your aisles there, pews or seats, whatever you want to call it, a little sheet of paper. If you want to write a prayer, we are going to have a time in the service where you bring that prayer. It can be Thanksgiving, it can be a concern, whatever it may be, and bring it to the cross. Bring it to the cross that reflects, you know, what Jesus did for us so that we can do that. So, and there's some more, I think, back on the table in the very back, too, if you need them. So, but we will get to that. So now it's time for our joys, but let's look at some birthdays. Elizabeth, what do we got there? All right, we got Larry Ray, you'll see on the 15th, and then his wife, Mary Ann, on the 21st. So that's a lot of celebration going on in the Ray household. Joan Adams, Ginger, I see, is here. So Melinda Spring and Patty Wheeler. Anybody else? Is anybody else here besides Ginger? Okay.
It's all you.
All right, Ginger. We're going to sing right to Ginger this morning, Lee.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Ginger. Happy birthday to you.
She was singing along, too.
Happy birthday, Ginger. And we didn't have any anniversaries, but if we have any special anniversaries and you want us to recognize those, speak up now or forever hold your peace. Okay, hold your peace. And anybody had a birthday anniversary out on Facebook land, thank you as well. We wish you happy birthday, happy anniversary. All right, we got one slide. The sun breaking through the clouds. Looks like maybe somewhere in Colorado where Bob Sutton is traveling. He does provide some amazing pictures of what's happening there. But we have a little bit of our own glory here, too. But those are some cool pictures. Thank you, Bob. Okay. Anybody else have any joys they want to share with us this morning? Really? None? It's a full house? All right. Everybody's a little bit shy. So, well, we're glad you're here. Oh, Jeannie, yes. We got to let our Facebook audience hear your joy.
Athleticism was not my strong suit. But I will say I'm excited. I got some couple bits of good news last couple of weeks. I re-signed a contract to go back to Branson and finish the mural I started, so I'll be gone in January and February doing that. And then this week I got accepted into the National Quarter Horse Congress trade show, which is in the world's largest horse show in Columbus, Ohio. They only allow 4 to 5 artists a year to come and participate in that. It's a month-long show in October, so I'm really excited about that.
All right. And if you can't tell, Jeannie's an artist. Look at those overalls. She's wearing her art. So, all right, I like that. You're going to Branson with Ransom. So, oh, and Amanda Clark. Okay, good. She's getting a little hiatus from Chick-fil-A and going to go paint. That's good. Yes, you can freeze it, and that's what you can eat. So, all right, wonderful. Any other joys out there? Okay. Now's our time to offer our gifts to God, so if I can get a few people to help me pass the plate, that would be great. Thank you, Ben. You like how we play a little more upbeat music when we do the collection, right? So it's a nice way to go. So let us give thanks for these gifts that we are offering God this morning. Heavenly Father, we give thanks for the generosity of this community, not just here in this church, but in so many ways, the folks that want to reach out and make a difference in others' lives. So, Lord, we bring these gifts before you this morning. We just ask that you would bless them, that you would help us to be good stewards as a church and as a body of Christ. In your holy name we pray. Amen. All right, now is the time where we bring our concerns to the cross, but we're going to do something a little bit special after you bring your concerns to the cross, and I'll just give you a heads up on that. So play a little bringing the concerns to the cross music, and then we'll go from there. We're going to pick on Jeannie this morning, and Jeannie's going to have surgery on her left wrist for the second time. Ooh, that's a good scar. In 8 weeks, and the doctors, we trust them too, but we're going to give this to God, and we're going to pray over Jeannie, and we would invite anybody that wants to come lay hands on Jeannie. And I don't know about you, but I truly believe that God has the power to do amazing things. He doesn't always do what we ask him to do, but he has the power to do amazing things. So I hope Jeannie can come back, and she's going to be throwing 90 mile an hour fastballs with that wrist when we're done praying for her. So, yeah, come on up if you'd like to lay hands on Jeannie. This is awesome. Almighty God, it's hard to describe your power. But here this morning, we lay hands on Jeannie, and we pray for healing for her wrist. Lord, we know you could heal the wrist before the surgeons get a hold of it. It is possible. We have that kind of faith. Jesus said, if you have faith, you can move the mountains. And Lord, we pray that upon Jeannie this morning. And for all those hurting and suffering, but especially Jeannie now. So please, Lord, be with the doctors, the nurses, and all those that will have a role in healing her hand. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. Now, I'd just like to pray for our concerns at the cross and the other concerns that we have out there. I really want to pray for what's happening in the Middle East and what's happening in Israel and Palestine. There's no easy answer, but that it's God's people in Israel. And we come from that, and we're a part of that. But there's so many hurting over there. And let's just offer that up and pray for wisdom for all the leaders, not just in the Middle East and Israel and Palestine and around there, but around the world, that we can just do what's right, which is giving it to God. So let's pray. Almighty God, you know the hurt in our world more than any of us can imagine, right down to the little babies, the mothers, and the families that have been broken apart by this terror. Lord, I just pray that you would somehow get into the hearts of all the peoples in this struggle. And may they turn to you and find peace in you, your peace that transcends all understanding. We beg you, Lord, and we beg of those people to open their hearts to you. And for the needs that we have placed upon this cross this morning, some of probably include what's happening in Israel and the Gaza Strip and all over the Middle East. We just pray that those that are hurting, that find your healing power. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And let us all say the prayer that Jesus gave us. Our Father, singing this together?
Yeah.
Okay. We can all stand up again. We're going to sing The Spirit of the Living God. Did you get enough time to get your lungs back?
Yeah. Spirit of the Living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the
We're reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 22, verses 1 through 14. Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it, and they went away, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go, therefore, into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guest, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to his attendants, bind him hand and foot, and throw him into the outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you, Jerry. So before I kind of formally begin my sermon this morning, I'm just mindful of this time of the year. So many of our seasonal folks are heading back to their winter homes. Talked to some of you this morning that that's the case, and I know some have left earlier in the month, and I just kind of want to give voice to that. And just for those of you who are heading home this week or very soon, just know that you go with our blessings and our prayers for a good and safe winter, and we just ask that you come back safely to us in the spring or summer, whenever that return is. One of the beautiful parts about being a part of this church and this community is the seasonal aspect of it. We always rejoice when our friends come back and miss them when they're gone, but I just want to give voice to that this morning, as I know some of you are making that transition. You know, weddings seem to be a very popular event in the Bible. Every gospel makes some reference to weddings, and I think we've, over the years, we've certainly had the understanding that weddings in that day, in Jesus' day, in that culture, were really great celebrations, huge events. You may remember that in the Gospel of John, John has Jesus' first miracle or sign take place at the wedding in Cana of Galilee when he changes water into wine. I officiated a wedding this past Thursday at the Colossagia Club. As I walked into the clubhouse, I had my robe on and my stole, and the parking attendant looked at me as I came in and said, "You must be the groom." When the photographer saw me, she said, "Well, you look snazzy." And I said, "Well, snazzy is what I was going for." So there we go. We had a good many folks there, 30 or 40 wedding guests. It was outside. It was beautiful. It was really a beautiful afternoon. Many were in long dresses or suits. Many were in casual attire. It was really quite lovely. Again, a lovely occasion. I've had the privilege of officiating at a number of weddings over the years. I've often said to folks here in Highlands, which is my fifth appointment as a United Methodist pastor, this is the first time that I've served a church in a community where I've actually done more weddings than funerals, which is really kind of neat, and I'm grateful for the blessing of that. And every wedding has its own unique and special beauty about it. The parable before us today is the parable of the wedding banquet. It's another of the several parables that you find in the Gospel of Matthew, especially around the kingdom of heaven. You may remember, if you were with us back in the summer, I think it was July, Nicole Calson, who was our Duke summer ministry intern, and I did a five-part sermon series. I think it was a three-part sermon series on the kingdom of heaven parables in the Gospel of Matthew, in the 13th chapter of Matthew. There were seven kingdom parables just in that one chapter, and we spent some time reflecting on that. This particular kingdom of heaven parable in the 22nd chapter comes at a time where there's a great deal of contention between Jesus and the religious leaders. I want to just give you a sampling, just kind of a quick flyover of the previous chapter, chapter 21, and the following chapter, chapter 23, just very quickly. In the 21st chapter, the chapter preceding this one, Jesus makes his triumphal entry into Jerusalem. He runs out the money changers from the temple. He curses the unfruitful fig tree. The chief priests and the elders question his authority. He tells the parable of the two sons. One son, the father says, "Go into the vineyard and work." And he says, "No, I won't," but later does. And then one says, "Yes, I'll go," but one says, "I will," but then he doesn't go. And the one says, "I won't," but eventually does go. And Jesus uses that to really kind of offer some words of condemnation. He says to the people, "Truly, I tell you, the tax collectors and prostitutes are going into the kingdom of heaven ahead of you, for John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him, but the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him." And Jesus goes on to tell the parable of the wicked tenants who killed the slaves and the landowner's son. And Jesus says, "Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruit of the kingdom." That's in the preceding chapter. In the following chapter, Jesus denounces the scribes and the Pharisees who, according to Jesus, do not practice what they teach, who tie up heavy burdens on others to bear, who love the seats of honor, who exalt themselves, who lock people out of the kingdom of heaven, who tithe mint and dill and cumin and neglect the weightier matters of the law, justice, mercy, and faith, who clean the outside of the cup and the plate, but inside are full of greed and self-indulgence. They are like whitewashed tombs, which on the outside look beautiful, but on the inside they are full of the bones of the dead and all kinds of filth. So this parable in the middle, this parable of the wedding banquet, it highlights and really is consistent with these tensions between Jesus and the religious leaders in this section of Matthew's gospel, serving as a warning to all who have rejected and who are rejecting the invitation to embrace the kingdom of heaven inaugurated on earth and embodied in Jesus. In the parable that you heard that Jerry read so well for us this morning, the king gives a wedding banquet for his son, and those who had been invited reject the invitation. The king sends more slaves. He even pleads almost with them this time, giving them an idea of the impressive menu that they will enjoy at the banquet, sharing with them the lavishness of the great feast at the wedding banquet. But again, the invitation is rejected. Some merely blow it off. Some go back to the farm, so come to the office, while others act more aggressively and mistreat the slaves and actually kill them. And as might be expected, their response was a great affront to the king, and so he sends an army to destroy those individuals and their city. And since those initial guests had proved unworthy to the king's invitation, slaves were dispatched once again into the streets to just invite everybody, get anybody they could, so they could fill the banquet hall. And eventually they did. The banquet hall was filled. It seems clear enough, given this parable's place in the gospel narrative, that Jesus is offering a cautionary word to the religious people of his day, his religious sisters and brothers, those who were raised like he was on the stories of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They were in danger of having the kingdom taken away from them and given to others. And it seems pretty clear that he wanted his audience to see themselves represented by those who first received the invitation in the parable but rejected it, to see themselves represented by those who mistreated the king's representatives. Just a little further, in the next chapter, chapter 23, Jesus offers these following words of lament over Jerusalem. We might say these are words of lament over the people's rejection of the king's invitation to the wedding banquet. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often have I desired to gather your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you are not willing. Now, if this parable simply stopped with Jesus saying that the banquet hall is filled, I think we could craft a good moral to the story. You tie up the sermon in a nice, neat bow. And the preacher could end the message with something like, and so we have been invited like everyone has been invited. So it's important for us to say yes to God's invitation in Jesus. And that would be true enough. But Jesus keeps preaching past a really good stopping place in his sermon. Did you hear the way the parable ends? Right after the banquet hall is filled with guests. Listen again. When the king came in to see the guest, he noticed a man who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe? And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, bind him hand and foot. Throw him into the outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And then Jesus offers a very different kind of moral to the story with that closing line. For many are called, but few are chosen. And so the parable that almost closed with a kind of triumphal image, the banquet hall filled with these newly invited guests, ends with a somewhat ominous and even confusing image as the scene fades to black. So what are we to make of this closing scene that brings the parable to this kind of haunting, awkward, and uncomfortable close? Well, actually, I was waiting for you to answer because I don't know. I'm really not sure, but this moment does make me think about something else that I read in the Bible. In the 11th chapter of the book of Romans, the Apostle Paul had something to say about the tension between God's plan of salvation amongst Jews and Christians. Here's what Paul said. He likened the Gentiles, people like you and me, to a wild olive shoot that had been grafted onto the branch is in place of Israel's branch. But he goes on to caution Gentile believers not to boast of their newly created place in the olive tree. Here's what he says. You will say, branches were broken off so that I might be grafted in. That is true. They were broken off because of their unbelief, but you stand only through faith. So do not become proud, but stand in awe. For if God did not spare the natural branches, perhaps he will not spare you. He goes on a little later to say, so that you may not claim to be wiser than you are, brothers and sisters, I want you to understand this mystery. A hardening has come upon part of Israel until the full number of the Gentiles has come in. And so all Israel will be saved. For the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable. Just as you were once disobedient to God, but have now received mercy because of their disobedience, so they have now been disobedient in order that by the mercy shown to you, they too may now receive mercy. For God has imprisoned all in disobedience so that he may be merciful to all. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments, how inscrutable his ways. Dr. Christopher Hudson was my New Testament professor at Hood Theological Seminary. His mother passed away this week. We're Facebook friends now, so I get to keep up with Dr. Hudson. I never met his mom, but I really wish I had after reading her obituary. It was humorous, and it was delightful in so many ways. One particularly juicy line toward the end of her obituary, where normally you have that place in the obituary where it talks about who preceded a person in death and who survives the person in death. It announced in her obituary that she was chagrined that her first husband, whom she had divorced many years prior, survived her. That's a woman I wish I would have met. One of the great lessons I learned in Dr. Hudson's New Testament class was his suggestion that we should never read Scripture in a self-justifying way. We should always read Scripture in a self-critical way. So in other words, when Jesus is having sort of this contentious moment with the Pharisees and scribes or religious leaders, whoever they may be, we should never paint ourselves on the side of Jesus listening to him give what for to those folks. We should appropriately find ourselves numbered among those folks and have Jesus point Jesus' finger at us. I wonder if Matthew's purpose in telling us the plight of this poorly dressed wedding guest is to keep us Gentile types from feeling too puffed up at our religious wisdom. So what are we to take away from this story? Does the wedding robe represent something important? Does it represent righteousness? Are the threads of the wedding robe made of the fabric of faith? How can we be sure that we are properly dressed ourselves for the wedding banquet? Over the years, I've seen more than a few church signs with a message that read something to the effect of, "Heaven or hell? Your choice." But according to this Kingdom of Heaven parable in the 22nd chapter of Matthew, the one who extends the invitation to the wedding banquet is the one who chooses. Many are called, but few are chosen. Then again, maybe this parable isn't really necessarily about heaven or hell. Perhaps it's not about who is in and who is out. Maybe, if nothing else, it can simply serve to remind us that when it comes to the wedding banquet in the kingdom of heaven, we're not in charge of the guest list. Admittedly, I can't fully reconcile the awkward tension that the end of this parable stirs within me, but I can't help but think that it may have something to say to any of us who at any time might be tempted to think of God's gift of salvation as anything other than pure 100% gift in and through Jesus. And if we understand the value of the gift of the invitation, we will respond with all we have and all we are. Back in the 13th chapter, Jesus offered these words: "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field which someone found and hid. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field." Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. And just in case you're concerned about what to wear to the banquet, may I suggest you visit a little clothing shop located in the ancient city of Colossae? You can search their catalog in the 13th chapter of the book of Colossians. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Above all, clothe yourselves with love. I don't know about you, but for my money, that sounds like a great outfit for any occasion. And this morning, we have a really special treat here in the 909 service. This Sunday has consisted of breakfast, bluegrass, and a biblical parable about a wedding feast. And perhaps you'll always remember this day, Sunday, October 15th, 2023, as the day when you came to church for a worship service and a wedding broke out. In just a moment, you'll all be witnesses of the marriage between Frank Crane and Sarah Henderson. But first, this song from Darren and Jennifer, at their request, "There Is a Reason."
Isn't any wonder that I fall? Why do we suffer crossing off the years? There must be a reason for it all. Trusted in you, Jesus, save me from my sins. Heaven is the place I call my home. But I keep on getting caught up in this world I'm living in, and your voice, it sometimes fades before I know. to believe, but help my unbelief. I've seen hard times, and I've been told there is a reason for it all.
Aaron, Jennifer, thank you. That was beautiful. Frank and Sarah, I'm going to invite you to come forward at this time. You just come stand before me here. Just stand facing me right now. Yeah, that'll be fine. Thank you. Dearly beloved, we are gathered together here in the sight of God and in the presence of these witnesses to join together this man and this woman, Frank Crane and Sarah Henderson, in holy matrimony, which is an honorable estate instituted of God and signifying unto us the mystical union which exists between Christ and his church, which Christ adorned and beautified with his presence in Cana of Galilee. It is therefore not to be entered into unadvisedly, but reverently, discreetly, and in the fear of God. Into this holy estate, Frank and Sarah, come now to be joined. I require and charge you both, as you stand in the presence of God, before whom the secrets of all hearts are disclosed, that having duly considered the holy covenant you are about to make, you do now declare before this company your pledge of faith, each to the other. Be well assured that if these solemn vows are kept inviolate as God's word demands, and if you steadfastly endeavor to do the will of your heavenly Father, God will bless your marriage, will grant you fulfillment in it, and will establish your home in peace. Frank, will you have this woman to be your wedded wife, to live together in the holy estate of matrimony? Will you love her, comfort her, honor and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep only to her so long as you both shall live? If so, answer, I will.
I will.
Sarah, will you have this man to be your wedded husband, to live together in the holy estate of matrimony? Will you love him, comfort him, honor and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep only to him so long as you both shall live? If so, answer, I will.
I will.
Now I'm going to invite you to take hands and face one another. And Frank, if you will repeat after me, saying to Sarah, I, Frank, take you, Sarah.
I, Frank, take you, Sarah.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
According to God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
And thereto I pledge you my faith. Sarah, if you will repeat after me, saying to Frank, I, Sarah, take you, Frank.
I, Sarah, take you, Frank.
To be my wedded husband.
To be my wedded husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, or poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
According to God's holy ordinance. And thereto I pledge you my faith.
And thereto I pledge you my faith.
Do you have the ring? Thank you. The wedding ring is an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual grace, signifying to all the uniting of this man and woman in holy matrimony through the Church of Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us pray. Bless, O Lord, the giving of this ring, that it may serve as an abiding symbol of the covenant into which Frank and Sarah now enter. May their marriage flourish in faithfulness to you and to one another through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Frank, would you place this on Sarah's finger as you repeat after me, in token and pledge,
in token and pledge,
of our constant faith and abiding love,
of our constant faith and abiding love,
with this ring I thee wed,
with this ring I thee wed,
in the name of the Father,
and of the Son,
and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
And of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Now I'm going to let you face me again for a moment. For as much as Frank and Sarah have consented together in holy wedlock, and have witnessed the same before God and this company, and thereto have pledged their faith each to the other, and have declared the same by joining hands in the giving of the ring, I pronounce that they are husband and wife together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Those whom God hath joined together, let no one put asunder. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, creator and preserver of us all, giver of all spiritual grace, the author of everlasting life, send thy blessing upon Sarah and Frank, whom we bless in thy name, that they may surely perform and keep the vow and covenant between us made, and may ever remain in perfect love and peace together and live according to thy laws. Look graciously upon them, that they may love, honor, and cherish each other, and so live together in faithfulness and patience, in wisdom and true godliness, that their home may be a haven of blessing and a place of peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Frank and Sarah, receive now this word of blessing. God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless, preserve, and keep you. The Lord graciously with his favor look upon you, and so fill you with spiritual benediction and love, that you may so live together in this life, that in the world to come you may have life everlasting. Amen. Amen. Frank, you may kiss your bride. I'm going to let you face, y'all get ready, let you face the congregation. Friends, it's my privilege now to present to you for the first time, Mr. and Mrs. Frank Crane. Congratulations.
Now, that's a tough act to follow right there. So I don't think I have much more to say other than you had no idea you were invited to a wedding banquet. But I want to assure you, we're not checking which robe you're wearing today. That's up to you. So go out there and clothe yourself in compassion and love and mercy on others. And may God bless you and may God keep you. Band. Fly us away.
Some glad morning when the slap is over, I'll wait to a home on God's celestial shore. When the shadows of his life have grown, will I fly away? Like a bird from prison bars is flown, I'll fly away.